Good evening. It's a pleasure for me to welcome you here this evening. My name is Avinoam Pat. I'm the Doris and Simon Conover Chair of Judaic Studies at the University of Connecticut, where I also serve as Director of the Center for Judaic Studies and Contemporary Jewish Life. It's a pleasure for me to welcome you here this evening for a very special program, TV Gone Jewy, featuring Esther Kustanowitz, who's joining us from Los Angeles. For those of you who are just joining class tonight, you should know that this is part of my Jewish humor class this semester. So there's going to be a pop quiz at the end of class. Everybody who has signed on for this program, just know that you're signing up for a final exam at the end of the class this evening. I will mention before I introduce our speaker that this is part of sort of a longer semester exploration of the history of Jewish humor, which the students have been hopefully enjoying for the most part. We're very excited to welcome Esther to talk about representations of Jews on television, especially in the present day. A couple of technical notes. The program is being recorded, as you can see. I'm going to introduce our distinguished speaker this evening who will speak, and I'm sure you'll have questions for her. I'd like to encourage you to use the chat function on the bottom of the screen to ask any questions that you may have, type them in. And then once Esther is done with her presentation, her remarks, we'll have plenty of time for Q&A and discussion, but we'll save those questions for the end of tonight's program. So it's really a pleasure for me to welcome our speaker this evening. Esther Kustanowitz is a contributing writer at the Jewish Journal of Greater Los Angeles, where she writes on topics ranging from comedy to grief, from women in Jewish leadership to social media culture, and is a TV columnist at J, the Jewish News of Northern California. She co-hosts The Bagel Report, a podcast about Jews and entertainment, and speaks about hashtag TV Gone Jewy, a term she invented to describe the increase of Jewish content on TV. She's been an early adopter of social media platforms, including blogging, Facebook, and Twitter, and she is well known as a source on social media engagement and culture, and is known as one of the Jewish world's social influencers. Esther has consulted for and spoken at dozens of organizations and institutions in New York, Los Angeles, the San Francisco Bay Area, and Israel, including the Jewish Federation of Greater Los Angeles, the ROI Community, IKAR, the American Jewish University, Yeshiva University, Slingshot, Limmud, UpStart Bay Area, and the Jewish Federations of North America. And now we are so excited to welcome her here this evening to the University of Connecticut, and specifically to our Jewish humor class. So I'm gonna turn the screen back over to Esther Kustanowitz. The screen is now yours. Thank you, Esther.
Thank you so much. It's great to be here with you in Connecticut. It feels like Los Angeles where I'm sitting, and that's one of the amazing things that we can do now that we have the opportunity to see people from all over the world. We can be in each other's homes without ever leaving our own homes. I'm going to present now, and please, I really do encourage you to ask questions. I will not be able to see them till the end, but I am reserving time at the end to take all questions and comments because this is a fascinating space that we're about to enter. Those of you who have been in the class already have gone through a lot of the kind of the preliminary moments of Jewish humor and Jewish comedy, specifically on television. You've already done that before, so I'm not going to waste time doing that. But what I'm focusing on right now is a very kind of contemporary look at what Jewiness on TV is right now, which is to say it mildly, it's definitely very present. And before we start, I just want to say that like some of these clips will be more accessible than others, both in terms of Jewish knowledge and in terms of audio. The audio should work on all of them. If you need subtitles, I have enacted subtitles where they are possible, but I don't have subtitles for everything. And for that, I apologize, because I and accessibility is, we're both works in progress. Also, because it could be on your end, it could be on our end, like, you never know where the Zoom is going to assert itself and say, I am in control of this. So if there are any problems with Zoom, hopefully just stay patient and we will get through them together. Some of the clips that I'll be showing have some harsh language, what my grandmother would have called fresh language. But I'm sure that many of you have heard worse, probably even today, maybe even in your homes. And as you have questions, please put them in the chat so you don't forget them, and we will answer them at the end. TV Gone Jewy is happening in a big way these days and is always happening. For instance, these are the two most recent things that I've seen. The first one is there was this TV show called Nurses on NBC that had a Haredi guy, a very ultra-religious Jew, whose son was refusing a bone graft because it came from a dead person. And there were a couple of lines in there that were kind of objectionable. They said, you know, well, it could come from an Arab or from a woman. And so then the nurse under her breath said, or it could be, God forbid, an Arab woman. And so there were a lot of controversies that kind of cropped up around this medical drama called Nurses. And it's not the first time. As you can see here, there's a whole article in the Times of Israel about Grey's Anatomy and Nurses and House and all the ways in which Orthodox Jews show up to be a different kind of character with different mindset than you're used to seeing in these shows. But, you know, in terms of refusing medical treatment, kind of portraying the entirety of religious Judaism in a negative manner. Also, you're seeing a lot more Shabbat happening. And the Jewish Sabbath, which comes once a week, this person is from the TV show Nancy Drew, and he has just lit candles and is explaining to one of the characters that the good thing about Shabbat is that there's one every week. And when I was growing up, there wasn't Shabbat, wasn't on television every week, and you didn't have Orthodox Jews of any stripe running into hospitals and talking about their medical ethics. That just wasn't part of the conversation. And even if it's flawed, I'm glad that it is part of the conversation, and we'll talk about that a little bit more as we move forward. But speaking of Shabbat, these are three different scenarios where Shabbat has come up in a fairly non-Jewish context. On the left, you have a TV show called Daybreak, which is about the apocalypse. And somebody is saying that we're partying like it's Friday. And then she says, Shabbat Shalom, bitches. And who knows? I mean, this character, I know the creator of this series, and this character, the series showrunner told me, had an extensive Jewish arc in season two. Netflix canceled it. There's no season two. We don't have the arc. But, you know, I think it's really interesting to know that this was on his mind, that he wanted to have a character in there who was Jewish and for whom that would be an issue and a reference point. On the upper right, you've got from Pose, which is about the voguing movement in the 80s. And this is somebody who's just announcing that this woman is there in white and apparently looks like a Shabbat bride, is the only reason I could see that they would say this. But who brought Shabbat Shalom, as if that's something that a phrase that's on the top of everybody's minds. And then on the bottom, you have from Shrill, somebody just phones in on a FaceTime app and says, what's up, Shabbat Shalom, even though there are no Jewish characters that you can see. Judaism is not a theme of the program. And it's just kind of interesting when these things pop up. Kosher is another thing that comes up a lot. Sometimes it comes up as kind of like a, you know, just kind of like, is that okay? Is it kosher? It comes up in a very like casual sense. But here in both of these scenes, one from The Blacklist, which was just from this past week, actually, where the main character goes and drinks something, but before he drinks it, he says, is this kosher? And then doesn't really get an answer, but then he says, l'chaim, and he drinks. And this character has not been Jewish, but this particular show has had a lot of little Jewy moments like this, punctuated throughout the seasons. On the right, you've got something from The Office, and you've got this kosher certified, and it's just a one-off. It doesn't really mean anything, but it's in there probably because some Jewish person in the writer's room found it funny. And also we have strong secular Jewish identity emerging where it's not just using the word kosher or, you know, having challah or babka or marble rye as you know, they had on Seinfeld, but places where they're mentioning things that are not necessarily in the vernacular. So for instance, we've got on the right, this is both from Schitt's Creek. So on the right, you've got Moira and Johnny Rose, and they're, she's talking about, she just threw something out the window and that some food out the window, providing a nice Passover Seder for a family of hawks, comes out of nowhere. It's not about Passover. It's not about Judaism. It's just, that's their reference point. And on the left, there's a scene where David has never done these kind of like outdoor climbing thing before, and somebody calls him a virgin, and he says, "You may want to talk to half my birthright trip about that." A lot of people may not know that birthright is a trip that's taken to Israel, that's given to young Jews between the ages of 18 and 26 as a gift to go to Israel and see what it's all about. But there was enough of an awareness that a birthright trip was something that could be mentioned here, and whoever got it would get it. One of the things that we look to when we talk about Jews on TV often is about the Jews who have changed their name to fit into Hollywood. And there are a bunch of people here from many generations, so hopefully some of you are looking at this list of names and you know some of these people's names already, but you probably don't know all of them because they are multi-generational. But I wanted to play for you this guy named Billy Eichner, who goes on the streets of New York, and he always accosts people on the streets and asks them lots of questions. Here he is talking to Rashida Jones, who's the daughter of Quincy Jones and Peggy Lipton. She identifies as Jewish. She identifies as Black. And so he is asking her questions about Jews who have changed their names. And I just think it's really funny and frantic, and I wanted to play it for you.
Hey guys, it's Billy here in Midtown Manhattan with the beautiful and talented Rashida Jones. Rashida is on Parks and Recreation, but that has nothing to do with the fact that we're about to play my new favorite game, Whistle Blow That Jew. How are you, Rashida?
I'm great, Billy.
Are you excited to play Whistle Blow That Jew?
Never been more excited.
Okay, here's how Whistle Blow That Jew works. I'm gonna run down a list of celebrities and what may be their original, more Jewish sounding birth name. If you think what I'm saying is not true and they didn't change their name, say not that name. If you think what I'm saying is true and they change their name from a more Jewish sounding name, say full of shame. Not that name or full of shame. Do you understand?
I understand.
Okay. If you get enough right, you win a big prize. All right. Are you ready, Rashida?
I'm ready.
All right. Well, if you're ready, now it's time to play Whistle Blow That Jew. Here we go. Not that name or full of shame. And away we go. John Stewart was John Leibowitz.
Full of shame?
Yes, correct. David Schwimmer was Jacob Snailman.
Not that name.
Correct. Natalie Portman was Natalie Hirschlag.
Shame.
Yep, full of shame, Natalie. Yep. Will I Am was Zach Steinberg.
Never that name.
Yes, correct. Kat Dennings was Catherine Litvak.
Oh, full of shame.
Yes, correct. Kat Dennings, you're full of shame. Okay, Paula Abdul was Rachel Ben-Hanica. Oh, Rashida, pull it together, God.
I wish. Never that name.
Never that name. Jonah Hill was Jonah Feldstein.
Full of shame.
Full of shame. Shia LaBeouf was Brisket Blousman.
Never that name.
Yes, correct. Kelly Clarkson was Sarah Gross Bittman.
Never that name.
Never that name. Correct. Brad Garrett is Brad Gerstenfeld.
Full of shame?
Yes, correct. God, you're good at this. Woody Allen is Alan Koningsberg.
Full of shame.
Yes, correct. Andrew Garfield was Aaron Yodelsberg.
Never that name.
Correct. Tyler, the Creator, was Moshe Ben-Moses.
Never that name.
Correct. Winona Ryder was Winona Laura Horowitz.
Full of shame.
Yes, correct. Correct. Three more. Mindy Kaling was Rebecca Schechter.
Never that name.
Correct. Correct. Bob Dylan was Robert Zimmerman.
Full of shame.
Yes, correct. Gene Simmons is Chaim Weitz.
Ooh. Never that name.
No, full of shame. I'll give you one more. Jackie Chan was Mel Schwartz.
Never that name.
Correct. Yes, Rashida, you win. Whistle blow that Jew. Let's see her prize. Oh, it's a plunger.
Okay. So it's a plunger. That's not really important. But what's important is that there were people here that probably you know. So we had Woody Allen, Alan Koningsberg. We had Jonah Feldstein, who's Jonah Hill. Catherine Litvak, who is Kat Dennings, And then there are a couple of other people here. We're just going to go to the, we've got Woody Allen. Melvin Kaminsky is Mel Brooks, of course. Jerome Silberman is Gene Wilder. We've got Skylar Lipstein, who you may or may not know as Skylar Astin, who was in the Pitch Perfect movies. Allison Schermerhorn, it's Allison Brie, and she's in a lot of things, Glow, and a lot of and Community, and a lot of other things. And Taika Cohen is, of course, Taika Waititi. And so the idea that, you know, are they full of shame? Did they just think it would be easier? You know, it's maybe a little harsh to think of them as full of shame, but I think that one of the things that you'll see over the course of the rest of this presentation is that people are leaning into their names and their identities very strongly. So I think we're going to be seeing less of this in the future. And sometimes even when there's stereotypes, when there's extreme stereotypes, you know, your people aren't going to be leaning into their Jewish identity at all costs. We'll come back to this and we'll see some of these clips in action later, but I wanted to give you a preview. This is Rachel Bloom in Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, and these are stills taken from a song called The Jap Battle Rap. And The Jap Battle Rap is about these two women who are lawyers, and they're kind of out talking each other. And they're all telling each one of them is telling the other why she's better than the other one. So, but these screenshots show you that there's very particular language that, again, would not have been on TV when I was growing up. Sheket Bavaka, shut the hell up, is like actually the PG-13 television version of what they actually say. And the idea, think your verse is tight, then you're tripping like birthright. There we have that, the reference to birthright again. And then, you know, she says, you know, that she's liberal as hell, but of course she supports Israel. And then Rachel saying below that we were egged on like Seder plates, which presumes the understanding embedded there that people know what a Seder plate is and that there is an egg on it for this to actually work and for people to understand all of the words that are coming out of their mouths. So why is TV going Jewy? I know that Gal Gadot is not really a TV star, but she has been responsible for a lot of the incoming Hebrew into American popular culture. So I just put her there as our little mascot. But I can tell you that it's because content creators are starting to pull from their own particular influences, their culture, and their experience. So for instance, Joey Soloway, who created Transparent, Jenji Kohan, who created Weeds and Orange is the New Black, and Glow, among other things, and Amy Sherman Palladino, who's responsible for The Gilmore Girls and for Marvelous Mrs. Maisel. And they are bringing their identities into these TV shows. Many of them, it's not the first TV show that they did that they were able to be so super Jewy. But it's been remarkable to watch them bring out their own individual identities on screen. You also have Jewish actors self-representing in a more prominent way than they used to, right? So that whole full of shame thing, like all of these people that I'm listing here are certainly not full of shame over being Jewish, and in fact are integrated into their identities, not just in terms of how they live their lives, but in terms of how they show up in public space representing popular culture, on social media, on, you know, in music videos, in the projects that they choose. They all, on the projects that they create, like Julie Klausner and Billy Eichner creating Difficult People, which is a super Jewy show, Abby Jacobson and Alana Gitlazer, Broad City, and it's not escaping me that a lot of these are kind of either the Gen X or the millennial kind of age groups, people who are feeling more at home in America with stories that highlight particular difference instead of hiding difference. And adding Jewish can provide like a lot of things when you're bringing it into a pop culture context. It can bring in conflict or establish a different faith or value system that people can learn about. It can add a distinct cultural flavor that's a little bit atypical. You know, there's a lot of the Talmud says, as you know, kind of like replacing Confucius says, you know, just kind of like these aphorisms that people can build their lives around. And also there's comedy and there's opportunities for family to come together. But through all of this, it's about finding meaning, and at least good Jewish portrayals should be about enhancing meaning that people have in the work. Gal Gadot, as I said before, is increasing Jewish literacy in a way that I think is notable. So I just want to take a minute to look at her comedy face here, where she, part of her monologue for Saturday Night Live was in Hebrew. That was the first time I'd ever heard Hebrew on Saturday Night Live. And the show was also broadcast live in Israel for the very first time because she was the host. And in her interview for Vanity Fair, she talked about a Jewish prayer of gratitude in the morning. And she talked about it in detail. She didn't just say, I say a prayer of Jewish gratitude in the morning. She said, here it is. You say Modeh Ani, which means I give thanks, and you get out of bed and you say thank you for everything. So she's actually really integrating all of this into her her tours when she's people are talking, asking her questions. So here are some of the questions that we talk about when we're reacting to TV Gone Jewy. And there will be some more clips coming up. Very excited to share some of these with you. And there, for everyone that I share, there are three that I had to leave out. So hopefully there'll be an opportunity to come back and do a second version of this. But when you're talking about how people react to TV Going Jewy, I kind of want to say that there are two audiences who react to TV Gone Jewy. One of them is Jews, wondering how Jews are going to be portrayed on TV. And then there is everybody else. And those are two very different audiences and very different levels of sensitivity in terms of the portrayals of Jewish characters. So one of the things that we ask are Jewish characters being portrayed by Jews? They don't necessarily have to be if they are portrayed accurately, right? But there are many Jews in Hollywood who have been told for years that they can't play roles because they're too Jewish, but then they can't get the Jewish roles because they're being played by non-Jews. So there's some kind of simmering challenges around actor equity in this particular moment. Also, are these Jewy moments fleshed out, or are they Jewish for the jokes? Those of you who have seen the Seinfeld episode with Bryan Cranston as the guy who, the dentist who converts to Judaism, so that he can tell jokes about Jews, or at least that's what Jerry thinks he's done. That's something that sometimes TV shows do that. They bring in a Jewish person so that they can have a bar mitzvah, or they bring in so they can talk about bagels and lox. And in that case, the Jew is just there for the joke. But in a lot of other cases, the character will emerge as a Jewish person and show and tell audiences what's meaningful to them through the natural course of the drama or the comedy. And I find that much more meaningful. The question of whether comedy portrayals have to be broad, or if they all have to be super serious and more new and as nuanced as dramatic ones. This is something that a lot of people disagree on. And I'm in conversations every single day with people who are talking about how Orthodox Jews are mistreated on television, or how secular Jews are misrepresented on television. And and so these are conversations that are constantly ongoing. And part of the challenge is because because Jews have been part of Hollywood for so long, but not necessarily so overtly Jewish. These kinds of conversations are conversations that people are just starting to have, and really trying to wrestle with how they relate to Jewish characters on television. And also, when you're talking about the Jewish community as an audience, we're very sensitive and we're very worried about what people think of us and whether one Jewish character on TV who is terrible will be imagined to represent all of Jews everywhere. So there's always opportunities in the Jewish community and in the Jewish press, which is one of the places that I do in my daily work, to talk about whether a particular character is treating Orthodoxy properly, is being respectful of the Holocaust and the survivors and the experiences of survivors, whether it's portraying Israel in a fair manner on both sides, on all sides, and the question of whether they are bringing shame to our community by airing our dirty laundry. So, for instance, if you have a Bernie Madoff, series on HBO, is that good or bad for the Jews? And it's not. It's at that point, I think it really shouldn't be about the Jews. It should really be just to be about. Yeah, we all know Bernie Madoff was a guy who made off with a lot of people's money and behaved reprehensibly, no matter what his Judaism status was. So I'll just take you through a couple of the different kinds of going Jewy to show you what I mean by that, which isn't necessarily the same thing as Jewish content, but it can be. So, for instance, you know, you have a lot of life cycle holiday events as a plot point or setting where people who don't usually see each other can get together. This is a huge opportunity for, you know, culture clashes, generation clashes, observance clashes, all of those things. So, you know, you've seen almost, I feel like 80% of the funerals I see on TV are Jewish funerals, and there's no reason for that, considering how small a percentage of the population Jews really are. There is also inside jokes for Jews, you know, that are like small references, kind of like the birthright references, that if you're not Jewish, you probably won't register it as anything that you need to take note of. And you probably won't get lost in the narrative just because you don't know what birthright is. But the numbers 6, 13, or 18, which are both known as to be Jewish numbers, you've got like the presence of yarmulkes or mezuzahs, the thing that's on the doorway that has the Shema in it, a piece of prayer that then you're supposed to kiss on going in and going out of the home. You've got Hebrew and Yiddish popping up in various places, and episode titles, which, you know, before Netflix, nobody knew what an episode title, what any episodes were really titled, except for people in the business. But now you'll see episode titles with Jewiness in them. You've got stereotypes, good and bad, overbearing mothers, parental guilt. You've got Jews in money, finance, diamonds. You've got lawyers, doctors, agents, anybody who behaves in a New York kind of manner. All of those things are stereotypes, and most often they are not well drawn out. Sometimes they're downright negative, but occasionally they're actually very endearing because they're familiar. And then there's conversations that add to plot narrative or character. So you have, like, you know, the Holocaust can show up in various places to justify why somebody is committed to social justice, for instance, or committed to eradicating hatred. You've got like somebody saying, hey, I didn't know you were Jewish, you know, or you're not really that Jewish or something like that. And then you get to learn a little bit more about the character when that happens. Sometimes, like I said, there's, you know, Jewish wisdom pops up that makes a larger point, you know, kind of like the wise rabbi who tells somebody something and they realize that they should have been doing that all along. So that's a trope that kind of shows up sometimes. And also the idea of Hebrew specifically and, you know, religious incantations being mystical. So like, you know, that there's an ancient Hebrew text in somebody's, and they're doing witchcraft, and that's just there. So we'll look at some of that stuff. These are all things, most of which we're not going to cover today, but I just wanted to show you in a paragraph how many other things we could be talking about. And I won't let you read the whole thing because we don't have time. But, you know, there's a lot of things happening all the time. And so Jewish holidays on TV also similarly, you know, it wasn't something that was around when I was growing up. You'd never hear, like, the name Purim anywhere. You might hear Passover. You probably would hear Yom Kippur. But other than that, Shabbat was very rare. But These are all holidays that have ended up on various shows, and I wanted to play this one clip for you from The Office.
Say shalom to your shrubs on this Jewish holiday that celebrates the new year for trees.
Tu Bishvat.
That's correct.
Woo! Hey, is it true that you're not allowed to spend time with your girlfriend during the month of Tu Bishvat?
I don't think so.
I knew it. It's Brian lies to me, says that he has a whole Jewish holiday for the entire month.
Right. So those of us who know what Tu Bishvat is, you know, say to shalom to your shrubs. It's the Jewish Arbor Day. It is not a month where you can't see your girlfriend, but because the character of Mindy Kaling's character on The Office was always hanging out with BJ Novak's character, except that they had this love-hate kind of relationship. So it clearly he had given her some sort of excuse dealing with Tu Bishvat that he couldn't see her. And so that's just the kind of funny insider thing that, again, if you don't know what you're listening to, then you don't know what, then you probably are able to enjoy that episode of The Office even without it. And Grey's Anatomy has been really interesting. You know, we talked about it before in terms of the medical show situation. But they also had this really interesting moment where they looked at where one of the characters on the show died, and one of the characters was in the room with him and realized that he needed to stay with the body because according to the Jewish tradition of Shmirah, you're supposed to be staying, you're not supposed to leave a dead body alone until it's the Chevra Kadisha, which is the Jewish Burial Society, arrives to usher it to the next place where it will be prepared for burial. So I thought this was really interesting because I don't recall, again, ever having heard the name Shomer, Shemirah, or Chevra Kadisha on TV before. And people, I don't actually really even watch Grey's Anatomy, but whenever something like this happens, people message me and were like, you have to watch this episode because this happened. And this was another example of that. Okay, so mystical Hebrew, just very quickly, we've got here the John F. Kennedy poster. We see it says Inshal Yadnak, except it doesn't really. It says Kennedy Lenasi. It's backwards. And also here for American Crime Story, you have Chatzor Yana. It really should mean Ani Rotzeach. This is an example of how Hollywood always gets Hebrew back, almost always gets Hebrew backwards. And it's like the letters are not backwards, but they're in backwards order. So they definitely need help with that. I don't know how to contact here, but you know, if for some reason anybody in Connecticut has that number, please let me know. But you know, I'm always happy to consult on these things for TV shows if they ever ask me. Here are three examples of mystical Hebrew. You've got like a challah recipe and a book on Just Add Magic with this is an Amazon Kids show. You've got Sude Elohim here is the name of God. In this mystical text on Sleepy Hollow, and here is the word Mavet, meaning death, on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. There's a whole separate subsection to be done about superheroes going Jewy. Here is, again, like these are things that I would not have seen growing up, even though there is a long and storied history of superheroes and Judaism, and the creators of superheroes having been Jewish and sometimes masking Judaism in their creation, sometimes overtly stating their Judaism. So here is something from The Flash, where one of the characters, who is a professor of physics, said that his father made him become a rabbi before he went to MIT, and then he's performing a wedding and he's skipping the Hebrew. Then we have on Batwoman season one, the character of Kate Kane, especially like in the comic books also, is a Jewish lesbian. So she's talking about the day of her bat mitzvah. She's talking to her sister. That's why it's our bat mitzvahs, because they had a bat mitzvah together. And so there's also like a very interesting thing that happened with Ray Donovan, which I'm just going to talk about super briefly, Ray Donovan obviously is not a comedy, so I'm assuming you won't be covering it in this course if you were part of the class. But it's really interesting for the way it portrays Judaism within a context of criminality. But as you see, there are three episodes at least that have Jewish names. One of them is the Golem. The second one is Rodef. Which is about if somebody's chasing you and wants to kill you, you're allowed to kill them first. And Shabbos Goy, which is the tradition for a religious family, if they don't use electricity on Shabbat, they have somebody who's not Jewish who comes in and does it for them. And so all of these themes were used as kind of metaphors to describe the different types of criminality that happen over the seasons of this show. And so there are two characters on this show who are in particular kind of emblematic of Judaism in various ways, and are bad for the bad characters, like they are both criminals. You have Avi in the lower right, who is a former member of Mossad, who is part of this whole fixing agency that Ray Donovan, who's played by Liev Schreiber, is running. And so he doesn't ask what did somebody do? He just, if he gets an order to kill somebody, he'll go kill them. But he would never miss a Shabbat with his mother. And Ezra Goodman on the left is also like, he's always spouting Jewish principles, but always in justification of his engagement in criminal activities. So he'll occasionally shout Tikkun Olam, or he'll try to like convince Raymond that he should kill a journalist who's doing an expose on the story, on his family and their criminal activities. So all of that is super interesting. And that kind of leads us to a brief conversation about the marvelous Mrs. Maisel and Unorthodox, which I want to just show you. I don't have any clips from either of these shows. They're both available. Maisel is on Amazon and Unorthodox is on Netflix. But there's a lot of conversation in the Jewish community about whether these are, because these are portraying to an extent stereotypes about either secular Jews from a certain era or Orthodox Jews from a certain geographical area. The question of whether these are bad portrayals or inauthentic portrayals is something that comes up quite a bit. They may be true to the time period or the location, but you know, depending on who you ask, if it conflicts with their own Jewish experience, people may hate it, or it may reflect something about someone's Jewish experience, in this, which case they would like it. But really nothing, I'm here to tell you that nothing represents modern Jewry as a whole, except having a lot of Jewish stories. As we are moving through, as we are in this common era, in this contemporary era, we also have to acknowledge that not all Jews are Ashkenormative. They're not all white, Eastern European origin Jews. And people who are not from New York City may be Jewish in different ways in various other locations as well. And so the press on both of these shows has been appropriately mixed. So you have, for instance, is Maisel marvelous? Very people don't like it. People love it. People hate it. It's like everything is possible when you have the internet. Like everybody can tell you what's right or wrong with it. And I think that probably I've read all of these articles and they all kind of have points, you know? So I think it's just really, it depends on where you're coming from. Unorthodox also, it's a misleading picture of Orthodox Judaism. They went to great lengths to get Hasidic Jewish customs right. You know, they're caricatures, it's riveting. So the question of like, you know, God bless the internet for the variety of opinion, that we have, available to us today, but it means that there's really no rave reviews of pretty much anything, these days, except for Shtissel, which is this, it's kind of like a weird little show, which some of you may have seen, some of you may be super fans of, some of you have never heard of it before, but season 3 is arriving, I believe, next week on Netflix. I've already pre-screened a couple of the new episodes, and they are extremely good. They're very well written, it's a little slower paced, the characters are still the characters that we love, but there's been a time jump so that they're a little older and maybe sometimes wiser, but not always. And also there was news that just this morning that Shtissel is going to be getting an American reboot. And Shtissel, it has a lot of comedy, but I would say it's a drama. And I assume that the same will be true of the American reboot. And I don't know how the American reboot is going to go, quite honestly, just based on what I read. I'm very nervous about it. I'm nervous for the show creator. but I hope she'll be okay. But the point is, when you're taking something so universally beloved, you know, the question of like how it's going to change into something else and still be acceptable to the people who loved it originally, I don't know. I'm very torn about it. All right. We're going to move into some clips from Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, which I introed before just a little bit. But Rachel Bloom, who plays Rebecca Bunch in the series, is a secular Jew who's very strongly identified in terms of her Jewish identity. And she is, just because she's secular doesn't mean she's not observant in her own way of Jewish of like being performatively Jewish, I guess, is one of the ways that that it was talked about in some of the books on the subject. But she's also graphically feminist. She's committed to talking about mental health issues. She's putting it all out there. And that's part of like the kind of millennial approach to storytelling that we also see on Broad City, which is like very much, it's all out there. Being Jewish is just part of those characters, just like it's part of the creators of the shows where these characters live. So let's get into the Jap battle rap, then we'll go straight into the Jewish stereotyping of the Jewish mother, and also into tackling the Holocaust, because, you know, let's just get it all, we'll just bang it all out. Here we go.
Hi, This is real deep beef from way back in the past. Deeper than I'll put a foot up in the crack of your ass. Come on, let's do this. Your little pals can witness how vicious this Westchester alpha bitch is. I'm straight up malicious, a verbal curb stomper. Since we were toddlers, I've studied every chink in your armor. And between your folks' divorce and that haircut on you, I'm really not sure which one's the bigger Shonda. That means disgrace. I'm translating for the goys. Our lifelines have been parallel like corduroys, but now we'll see whose bars will prevail in this beef of two hard as nails. She brews from Scarsdale. We've got a conflict of interest. I'm about to give Levine the business. Spitting venomous hate, penetrating her defenses. It's a jap battle.
A what?
A Jewish American princess.
Rap battle.
Daughters of privilege.
Spitting mad flow.
Find that from offensive.
Too bad, yo. Oh snap! It's a jap battle rap. Look, academically, you could never catch me. You were close, but no match scholastically. No how, no way. I put the OG in 5.0 GPA. Well, speaking of which, are you AP graded? Cause these days you look a bit heavily weighted. And all your book cracking don't make up for the fact that I'm strapped with that killer instinct that you lack. Sweetheart, here's what you're not understanding. I'm street smart. You mean cause you minored in urban planning? Bitch, I know you. That tough act's a bluff. So shake it, bavaka, shut the fuck up. Your temper, you lost it. Oh, cute. Like you're gonna lose this lawsuit. But here's one category where you have no rival. Blowing frat guys with your AE pie hole. And I banged your hedge fund manager fiance. Back in college over winter holidays. Bathroom stall at the matzo ball. And honestly, I gotta say, really not hot at all. Small dick, rotten lay.
This is
a jap battle.
Bane of my existence.
You're an asshole.
From Golden Bridge
to North Castle. Wipe you off the map in this jap battle rap. Bunch, you're a curse, you're a blight. We were frenemies at first spite. Think your verse is tight? Then you're tripping like birthright. I'll wipe the mirth right off your fugly mug and fill you full of slug like a straight up thug. That word is racist, someone ought to tell you. Like me, I belong to the ACLU. Spare me, I'm a card carrying member. Plus, I spent a semester in Kenya, remember? Well, I volunteered in Ghana. Well, I guess that makes us equal. Well, it's settled then. We're both cool with black people. Cause we're liberals.
Duh, progressive as hell.
Though, of course, I support Israel. Audra, wait, we share so many traits. Should we shake hands and erase the hate created by our mothers pitting us against each other for accolades and grades? We were egged on like Seder plates. Nah. In summation, you left New York for this fucking shtetl. Now you're like, oh, Audra, let's settle. You wanna get salty like the Dead Sea? Word, but call off the suit or your Dead Sea word.
All right, well, that... I just wanted to show you that there's also a glossary for this because there's a lot of Jewy words in there, and I've never seen a glossary like this for a song that had so much Jewiness in it. As people, some of you are in Connecticut, so you are no doubt locations mentioned in this song, but, you know, birthright, shtetl, Seder plates, matzah ball, sheket, bavakasha, and there's more. There's really more than they even have here. All right, let's go to Where's the Bathroom. This is Rebecca's mother comes to visit.
Where's the bathroom? Where's the bathroom? I need to use the bathroom. Tell me that you have a bathroom in this hovel you call home. I don't know which was bumpy, or the plane ride or the taxi. All these freeways are a nightmare. Where's my purse? I need my comb. By the way, you're looking healthy, and by healthy, I mean chunky. I don't mean that as an insult. I'm just stating it as fact. I see your eczema is back. Are you using the lotion that I sent you? If you're not gonna use it, I'll return it to the store. God, I give you everything, and still you just want more. Where's the bathroom? Where's the bathroom? You haven't told me where your bathroom is.
It's upstairs.
Okay, fine, I need the walk. Well, your house is charming, though some florals wouldn't kill you. Do you ever get a maid here? It's so nice to sit and talk. Since when do you have a vendetta against vases? When did you stop wearing makeup? Are you sure that you're not gay? I'd still love you if you were gay. It would explain this vase vendetta. Please just tell me if you're gay.
Again, I am not gay.
Don't interrupt me. You're always with the talking. I just got off a plane. Give me a moment to catch my breath. It's the least you can do since you lived inside me for 9 months and you still haven't told me where the hell your stupid bathroom is. bathroom. That's what passes for a bathroom. There were no bowls of rocks or any decorative soaps. You don't even have a bath mat. Who doesn't have a bath mat? If you need a bath mat, I can... Oh, did you hear? A bishop in Wisconsin said something anti-Semitic, so the temple has decided to boycott cheddar cheese. Everyone asks how you're doing. How is Widow Becky? Is she still a big shot lawyer? And to that, I just say, please. You won't get a husband this way. At least you have your career. Oh, wait, you threw out your career to chase this California dream. I wasted all the dough on a Harvard and Yale for you to be living in a dump in nowhere USA. Getting fatter by the minute on this greasy, gorgeous food. Just put my luggage in my room. Could I get a glass of water? I'll be back in a moment. I need to use the bathroom again.
I kind of want to slide along the wall after hearing that song again, too. The idea of Jewish guilt is something that is familiar to us and also is something that we're a little ashamed of. And Jewish mothers can be amazing and supportive, and they can also be very critical and challenging. And so that is very much, there is a lot of truth in there, even if it provokes some discomfort. Now let's move on to something less controversial, remembering the Holocaust.
Now it's time to celebrate. Grab a drink and fix a plate. But before you feel too great, remember that we suffered. Nights like these are filled with glee, noshing, dancing, singing, wee! But we sing in a minor key to remember that we suffered.
Being happy is selfish, remember that.
Such a crime for the Beastie Boys or Haim to mention in their songs one time, remember that we suffered. I don't want to bring up the Holocaust. I know the Holocaust, but the Holocaust was a really big deal.
Remember that we suffered.
This DJ is terrific.
Remember that we suffered.
My grandma's a survivor.
Remember that she suffered.
I can't hear you.
Remember that we suffered. Hey!
All right. Yes, remember that we suffered. So I think that it's clear that there are a lot of things we could talk about when it comes to how the Holocaust informs Jewish identity and how different generations feel that should be incorporated into life. But this idea of like, whatever you're doing, remember that we suffered, is something that's really intensely Jewish. It's built into all of our holidays. They tried to kill us. We survived. Let's eat. It is built into the Jewish wedding ceremony of crushing a glass to indicate the world is still a broken place, even at a moment of extreme joy. These are all things that are very true to the Jewish experience. But the challenge of like putting it out there for the rest of the world can sometimes make people uncomfortable. Okay, we have one more clip that I would like to, there's also, you could talk about basically all these three songs as pillars of secular and cultural Judaism. You know, if you talk about modern Jewish identity and what it means in the rap battle, and also, you know, the challenge of Jewish parents and the generation gap and where's the bathroom, that we see that. And also remember that we suffered, the role of the Jewish, of how Jewish history defines our present and our daily lives. That's all super interesting to talk about, as is the fact that the Association for Jewish Studies annual conference in 2017 did a whole bunch of workshops based on, they had a bunch of these papers that were presented on various aspects of Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. But I want to end with this one clip from Orange is the New Black. It's really one of the most powerful pieces of Jewish identity portrayal that I saw. And because Orange is the New Black, it can't decide whether it wants to be a comedy or a drama. So like, let's treat it for what you think it is. But I happen to think that this particular piece is very moving. And then we'll close up and there'll be some time for questions. So if you haven't been putting questions in the chat now and you have some, now is the time.
I still don't understand what I'm doing here.
You were part of my bait dead.
Excuse me?
I'm converting. This year's Ginsburg, she's been helping me out. And that's Boyle. I know her name don't sound Jewish, but she Jewish on her mama's side. And her great uncle died in the Holocaust, and she taught me the Hebrew alphabet for granola bars. So I'm here to present my case. I'm here to ask three times and get told no and no and then yes and then be a Jew. I'm here to take the name Tova, which means good, because it's all good now. I've been working for real, Rabbi. Try me. For serious, I'm ready to get my Jew on. And it ain't just about the food. Although, the more I've been learning, the food a big part of it, am I right?
She's been really dedicated.
Why she wants to go from being a hated minority to a double-hated minority is beyond me. But she's for real.
We've been studying, arguing. Hey, you wouldn't happen to be related to Amy Tatelbaum, would you?
She's my cousin.
Oh my God. We were at Penn together. Wait, Alan? Cousin Alan? I know some things about you. Oh, Alan, you better bait in this woman before I start to talk. Ask, Tova, ask.
Hey, can I be a Jew?
No.
Can I be a Jew?
No.
Can I be a Jew?
You really want this? Sincerely. Not because this one's trying to blackmail me for something stupid when I was 19, or for broccoli with your dinner. What is this for you?
Honestly, I think I found my people. I was raised in a church where I was told to believe and pray. And if I was bad, I'd go to hell. If I was good, I'd go to heaven. And if I'd asked Jesus, he'd forgive me, and that was that. And here y'all say it ain't no hell. Ain't sure about heaven. And if you do something wrong, you got to figure it out yourself. And as far as God's concerned, it's your job to keep asking questions and to keep learning and to keep arguing. It's like a verb. It's like you do God. And that's a lot of work. But I think I'm in, at least as far as I can see it. I mean, maybe I'll learn more and say, fuck the whole thing. I mean, but I want to learn more, and I think I got to be in it to do that. You know, does that make sense? Shit, did I just talk myself out of it?
Ask me again.
Can I be a Jew?
Yes.
No, I need three answers.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah! Look at me now, I'm a bona fide Jewish Jew!
Sort of. It's not really official without the mikvah, but that was wonderful. Really, Tova, congratulations.
What?
Oh, it's like, it's like a baptism, but without all the touching. You soak in a pool and you clean off all that Christian filth that you've been carrying around.
We can fake that shit in a shower.
No, that won't count.
The mikvah needs to be pure, naturally occurring water, and you need to be fully submerged and nude.
Yeah. Maybe it'll rain, okay? We could just, there'll be a sinkhole or something, and we'll make it official then. In the meantime, you are Jew-ish, huh?
All right. So in this clip, I've watched it 100 times at this point, and that ask me again, where he asks, tells her to ask her again, is just like, it gives me chills because it's a point at which he's like actually decided to go ahead and say that she can be Jewish. And immediately after he calls her Tova, which I think is also so beautiful, he accepts her new identity immediately. But this also, this particular moment, this four and a half minutes, has also a lot of Judaism in it. We learn the process for conversion, the concept of a Beit Din, a group of judges who sit and who can say that the person becomes Jewish. An articulation of what draws her to Judaism, which is something that a lot of Jews can't even articulate, quite honestly. The mikvah, the Jewish ritual bath and its basic requirements, and also that, you know, Jews who went to Penn can go to prison. Like, it's not, you know, that is something that is a, you know, there's a stereotype about Jews always being very high academic performers and very moral, but, you know, the idea that there are Jews who commit crimes and go to prison. So that's important to have also. And, you know, just fit in a little game of Jewish geography to see, you know, what other Jews do you know? And also, you know, this is something that that we also need to challenge ourselves with, especially if we are white or Ashkenormative, to not assume that every person who is Jewish has the same background that we do. Okay. I'm stuck in a loop here, but I'll get there eventually. Okay, we're not really skipping inclusivity, diversity, and representation. We're just not going to talk about it deeply right now, but just I want to ask you to think about this for yourselves. When you see Judaism on television, what does that mean to you? Does that mean that it's like you or that it's something that you relate to? And as the Jewish demography changes, what Jewy is will also change. Okay, yes, there's all of this. We don't have enough time to do everything else, but I want to skip to the end and just say that in summary, there was too much to cover. And, you know, I'm sorry if we didn't get to your favorites. Jewy is ever shifting. And what we have now also builds a lot on the Jewish comedies of the past. There are other people who present on that, including my father, who's on this call. If you're interested in the Jews of the previous generation on TV and before that, and that stereotypes of Jews behaving badly is really only a problem when they're the only portrayals. So I'm a fan of more portrayals so that we see that Jews aren't all one thing. And I have every hope that as we move forward, we're going to see more and more stories about Jews. And if you like this presentation, you also may like my podcast, The Bagel Report, which is, there's a lot of great pop culture and Jewy stuff there too. And if you're interested in contacting me afterwards, here is my information. But I am going to, I'm going to pause the share. I'm going to actually give the mic back to he who brought me here. And hopefully we can have some great questions. I thank you all for spending some time with me and look forward to more presentations like this in the future.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you so much, Esther. Great. And let's just do sort of the virtual round of applause for really an excellent sort of very comprehensive presentation. Really amazing. There's so much material that you covered and pulled together. That was awesome. So thank you so much for sort of giving us that overview. There's a lot of questions that are starting to come in, and I want to encourage folks, if you have questions, to type them into the chat. I'm going to try to gather some of them together and ask you some of these questions. And I know that for the students who are here with us this evening, you touched upon a lot of points, a lot of things that I haven't been able to cover in class myself. That's going to give us a lot to discuss in class as well. I'm going to pick up on one question that just came in from Eitan before I scroll back up to earlier in the chat, who asks, there have always been Jewish writers, producers, actors, as you alluded to in Hollywood, sort of we know about this history. So what accounts for this going mainstream recently? We just talked about this in class yesterday, meaning last week we were doing Seinfeld and this week we're doing Curb Your Enthusiasm. And one of the hypotheses that we raised in class is that one of the important things that happens is the transition from network television, where, you know, so the execs at NBC are concerned about greenlighting a show like Seinfeld that's perceived as too Jewish and will it play in Des Moines? You know, Vincent Brooke writes this book about the rise of the Jewish sitcom, and he has a thesis for like what happens in the 80s and 90s. But what do you think about, as an explanation, going from network television where you have three channels and you have to reach a huge audience to HBO and subscription services like Curb to where we are today with tons of streaming content, and you can have very, very niche audiences and a lot of shows that can sort of get, you know, the green light that never would have gotten made when we had just the big networks. Does that explain it for you, or do you think there's more going on?
I think there's a lot. I think the widening of the pipeline of content is huge. And also the focus on diversity and about specific stories, ethnically specific. You know, we had, you know, however many years ago, it's probably 20 years already that My Big Fat Greek Wedding was out there. And, you know, that was a very particular community, but in portraying that particular community, you didn't have to be Greek to understand what was going on there. You didn't have to be Greek to understand the pressures of a family trying to convince you to maintain the way that you had always been, that you were expected, the road that you were always expected to go on. And I think also it's about proven showrunners, people who are creators, having opportunities because of the things that they've done before that weren't particularly Jewish. They used to say like that in Hollywood, people used to do like, you know, one for them, one for me, you know, that they would just like do like a big blockbuster that didn't really mean anything, and then do a small independent film that was like very personal and they felt connected to. And I feel like in some ways that is what's going on here. You have, for instance, Jenji Kohan, who has done a ton of work before Orange is the New Black. And in Weeds, there was also like a rabbi storyline. There was also like, you know, there have been like little moments that she's dropped in for kind of, I guess, like diversity and color in the overall narrative, which may not be Jewish. But because she's had certain experiences, she wanted to have those portrayed on screen as well. So, you know, by the time she gets to Orange is the New Black, this is that clip is from the third season, and the arc for Cindy is a several episode arc. And then after that, she's kind of the Jewish voice on the show, which is interesting, that she really kind of steps into her, like identity as a Jew and just becomes Jewish and reacts as a Jew. So I think that's been really interesting. And those showrunners, when they feel their Judaism very strongly, you know, you get something like Rachel Bloom, who had not been a showrunner in particular, like a real mainstream show before Crazy Ex-Girlfriend, but was very popular on YouTube. She created the space that she was going to be her authentic identity in, and there was a lot of Judaism in the music clips that she created before Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. So people knew when they signed her that they were getting that from her. So I think that's, you know, it's harder for somebody who's never done anything in Hollywood that's successful to come in and say, I want to do something that's super Jewy. But again, Joey Soloway also had been on, 6 Feet Under and United States of Tara and all of these other things before creating Transparent, which is, again, it's a whole other lecture that we could get into. Does that answer your question?
Yes, I think that's, and I've joined you now on this, I've spotlighted myself to join you on the screen. It's a really interesting explanation because it's a number of factors coming together, right? That people who have sort of, you know, earned the right to produce shows that might be more about themselves or might deal with more explicitly Jewish context, but it's not the first show that they create necessarily, which is interesting. I mean, there's so many examples that we could talk about, which you alluded to your discussion as well. And it does strike me, as I was watching the Cindy clip, I was also thinking about how amazing it is that, you know, we have Tiffany Haddish, who just won the Grammy for Black Mitzvah, right? And she, if you've watched that that sort of comedy special, she comes out, you know, with Hava Nagila being raised, lifted in a chair, sort of dancing around the stage. I mean, it's sort of incredible to think about that and what that means. There's so many good questions have come in. A number of people are asking about stereotypes.
Yeah.
So Both Lance and Alana are asking questions about stereotypes. Lance writes that I get very uncomfortable when comics such as Jon Stewart, Leibovitz, right, makes fun of being Jewish in a way that Lance writes, I believe Jews may find funny, right? So there's like insider jokes where you talk about sort of stereotypes of Jews, but that also give permission for non-Jews to make fun of Jewiness, right? So it's this question of who gets to tell the jokes. And Lance like asks, usually these comics do not counterbalance their comedy with respectful Jewish moments. So what do you think of this question about sort of like, you know, Jews either engaging in self-deprecating humor and making fun of Jewish stereotypes, but at the same time, if those jokes were told by non-Jews, we'd wonder if that sort of crosses over into anti-Semitism. So do Jewish comics bear some responsibility for like presenting those negative stereotypes on television or in movies?
I mean, I think it's a great question because, you know, John Leibowitz, now I'm calling him John Leibowitz. I'm going to force everybody to be in their Jewish names, whether or not they want to. But Jon Stewart is like one of those people who, for certain people, he is like God. He's like the Jewish God of TV and, you know, of fake news or whatever they call it. But before it was fake news, I'm not getting into that. But anyway, the idea that, like, you know, he is also kind of trained as a stand-up comic from that previous generation of stand-up comedy people. So you have like Jerry Seinfeld and, you know, whose Jewiness, like, we all knew he was Jewish. He didn't bother changing his name. But he didn't really talk about Judaism so much. And when you talk about the, just if you want to track the evolution in some way, it's like, as, because Judaism was something kind of like to be kind of like very nervous about, like, you didn't really want to talk about it. You didn't want, you'd be like, if you were talking about it, it was because you wanted to point out something funny so that you could say, oh, I'm Jewish, but I'm also funny. You know, and these stereotypes are things that I see, so I can say, ha ha. And, you know, it's part of what I see when I'm observing the world. You know, in terms of, you know, I don't think necessarily that comedians see their job as counterbalancing their comedy with respectful Jewish moments. They're looking for jokes and they're looking to comment on life. And so I think that I don't expect them to do kind of like time counterbalancing it. But I see your point. Like, there are points at which, like, even the Jewish mother song from Crazy Ex-Girlfriend is like, it's hard to take in a 3-minute burst like that. It's like, you know, basically it's all Tova Feldschuk just kind of like holding court through this every possible Jewish stereotype of an overbearing Jewish mother that is crammed into 3 minutes. And when I finish watching it, some people are like, oh my God, that was awesome. I laughed the whole time. And I'm just like, I hear that. That was not my response. I have challenges with this, but it doesn't mean that I don't see things in it that I can relate to. So I think it's a very complicated question to ask somebody whose primary role is to tell jokes to also counterbalance it. But I know that the Jon Stewart in particular was a little bit of a disappointment to a lot of people about that, like that he didn't do more Jewy things.
Good. Yeah. No, it's so interesting to look at that dynamic. And I think I take your point about sort of the job of the comedian or the humorist is to get people to laugh, right? And sort of they'll do whatever they have to do in order to get people to laugh. And the question of like, do they have to serve as representative of the Jewish people? I mean, I'm sort of reminded of in Curb Your Enthusiasm when Larry is whistling Wagner in the line and the guy comes up to him and says, are you Jewish, right? And sort of criticizes him for you know, enjoying Wagner and accuses him of being a self-loathing Jew. And Larry's response is, I may hate myself, but has nothing to do with the fact that I'm Jewish, right? So there is like this sort
of— And I think that's actually a borrowed line. I think that's from somewhere else. I feel like I've heard that before, maybe in a Woody Allen movie or something. You know, and that's, I mean, I think that when you're tracking, like, in particular, Larry David, you know, who was a driving force behind Seinfeld, which had almost no Judaism except for these cringeworthy caricatures almost of like the moyle and the rabbi, and it was terrible. And I looked at those characters and I'm like, I wasn't like, oh yay, there's a rabbi and a moyle on Seinfeld. I'm like, really? It has to be them? They have to be like that? And so I think, but you know, with Curb Your Enthusiasm, there's a lot more Jewish stuff happening. Like, it's, you know, it's talking about inviting a survivor for dinner, you know, or like, you know, or when he realizes that being Orthodox might actually get him access to something. So he puts it on, and what does that mean? And those are stereotypes, but he's also Jewish performing them. But he's performing them not out of devotion to Judaism, but out of devotion to himself, because that's his whole framework. So I think it's really interesting. And then you have on the other layers that I didn't get to, which is the Jews are coming, which you did a session about also, which in some way, which has a sketch that is a kind of a parody of Seinfeld, but super Jewy and super biblical. And then you have Yid Life Crisis, which was thinking about doing, their initial thought was thinking about doing Seinfeld sketches translated into Yiddish, they told me in an interview, but then they decided that wasn't, that they really wanted to do their own thing, but certainly that Seinfeldian kind of like two guys sitting in a deli, like talking at each other, is very much an inherited from Seinfeld. So,
definitely, and doing it in Yiddish, or, you know, you almost showed this clip, which I'd encourage people to look up online, which is Yehudim Bayim, and we're going to do this later in class, the Jews are coming, the Israeli sketch comedy show that is so Jewish in terms of its content, and they have this brilliant clip of sort of their take on Seinfeld, but it's, instead of a show about nothing, it's kind of a religion God about nothing. So I want to get to a couple more of the questions that have come in. Brian asks about this question about Hasidic or Orthodox characters on TV, which you alluded to in terms of unorthodox, but there are other examples. So why do you think we're seeing this? Is this the Shtisel effect? Is there something else about these representations of Hasidic, Haredi communities on TV? Are we going to see more of this? What do you think is going on with this?
Yeah, it's really interesting because Shtisel, I never would have thought would be a breakaway hit in America. Like, I thought it was too small, it was too slow, it's too insular. But the reality was that that was about a family and the way they have a dynamic. And that's what was resonating for people, not just in America, but worldwide, and not just Jews, but everybody. And so I think people really liked that. In terms of unorthodox, which people, you know, lump into the same category just because there's orthodoxy involved, it's a very different kind of story. And it's a story of departure from the insular community because it's viewed as a restrictive place and is not able to give the character what she needs, so she leaves. And, you know, in the leaving, gets chased after by members of her community who want her back. Not because they value her, but because it's embarrassing that she left. And so that kind of, those two properties are very different in terms of the way they approach orthodoxy. And it's something that people are talking about a lot now, that orthodoxy is often invoked as a place to show restriction, as opposed to showing beauty and tradition. And so for people, I mean, I happen to not be orthodox, and so I understand why somebody would choose not to be orthodox, but people who are orthodox feel slighted by this approach, and I think that because orthodoxy is so extreme, and yet so a lot of people don't understand what it is. You know, they think it's just all about restriction for restriction's sake, and for the people living in that community, that's not what it's about. So there's no real kind of the counterbalance that Lance was talking about before, is not there. It's not like, this is a beautiful community, but it's not for me, because that's not good drama. You know, like, it's this is a community that's terrible and oppressive for me, and that's why I'm leaving. And that's a different narrative, a dramatic narrative. So if you're talking about, like, it's the same reason, I'll just double on and answer Brian's question about the funerals also, is that because there is such strong strong customs around Jewish funerals and Shiva and all of those things that are associated with the loss of a person. And because emotions are already high, you know, it's a great place for characters to have conflict and interact in a very fiery way, in whatever way, very passionately, and to make big choices because they're under the strain of this particular moment in their life, or they're encountering a person who is judging them for the choices that they've made in their lives. So I think that often it's invoked as othering, because it's also assumed, I think, that Orthodox Jews, especially ultra-Orthodox Jews, aren't watching these things. So if there were ultra-Orthodox Jews in the writer's room for Unorthodox, you'd probably have a different show. But that wasn't a priority for the creators of that show. But the person who created Shtisel is a former Haredi Jew. So he knows that world inside and out. He knows what he loves about it, and he knows what he doesn't love about it. And so he shows both of those elements to it. And I think that's why it's resonating and why Unorthodox isn't, and why a woman of valor, a price above rubies was that one. And then there was the Melanie Griffith Stranger Among Us, like, yeah. Every time. And there was another, there was a Woody Allen movie, I think, or maybe it just felt like a Woody Allen movie, where with Liev Schreiber, where he played like an EMT in the Hasidic community, right? So like all of those things are about like people who were restricted and feel like they need to burst out. So like, you know, it's interesting to use as a dramatic device, but I think that I'm more comfortable with it when it's not just a dramatic device, when it's actually, you know, there's a challenge around, not just challenge, but like nuance about the decision, like knowing it's not like a no-brainer, like you're being abused, you leave, you know, which isn't necessarily a no-brainer because there's obviously emotional challenges with that too. But like if I'm feeling like I want to do something here and I can't do it here, so I'm going to leave, but I'm going to miss my family and I'm going to miss all of these things. And I wish there was a way I could take it with me, and maybe I can actually ask them to accept me the way I am. And there's not a lot of that happening. I think it's mostly used as a differentiator. Yeah.
It's interesting because it'll be interesting to see how they remake Shtisel an American context, because in the Israeli show, you have the emotional complexity of sort of wanting to maintain sort of a belonging in the community, wanting to maintain some allegiance to the faith of one's father in the role of Akiva specifically, but also sort of really wanting to maintain, you know, have some independence and, you know, wrestling with their own identity issues. And that is what makes the show so sensitive. It's not just like holding up sort of the Haredi community to just tear it down and say, this is a symbol of something. It wrestles with sort of the complexities of that. I will say that one thing that's interesting is just to see the importance of Israeli television and films, and sort of a very highly developed sort of TV environment and film environment that I think is having a major impact. And we could talk about all the TV shows that have, you know, gotten their starts in Israel and then crossed over here to, you know, the American remakes, you know, HBO when they did B'Tipul and Treatment, or Chatufim, which is Homeland, or now we're gonna see, you know, Shtisel in an American remake. Like there's a lot of examples of this with Israeli shows that are getting remade in the United States. I want to ask two more questions. Are you okay with that, timing wise?
Yeah, totally.
Okay.
Please.
So there's a question here that brings up actually a comment that brings up Borat, and I want to turn it into a question, because okay. I do think that what Sacha Baron Cohen does, to go back to our use of like comedy and anti-Semitic stereotypes, is really interesting. And it raises this question of like sort of how effective is the mockumentary format to, in 2006, to like expose racism and homophobia and xenophobia and anti-Semitism in the American context. And then he does it again, I think very effectively in 2020, actually with like political implications. Mm-hmm. But what's so interesting about what he does in the film is he has this anti-Semitic Kazakh journalist speaking Hebrew throughout the whole movie. And we discussed this with the class, like who gets that aside from a Jewish audience? which, you know, which then raises the whole question. And he's speaking Hebrew, like it's not just mishmash. It usually fits within the dialogue of the context that he's in. So what do you make of that? I mean, what is this, we've talked about this in the class. Is this just a form of double coding where it's like the birthright joke that Jews will get and non-Jews will just sort of gloss over? Or do you think there's something deeper that Sacha Baron Cohen is trying to achieve here with this? Well,
I think he's such a layered performer that he's always trying to do something on top of something else. I always think that he's never just going for like the easy joke of slipping on a banana peel, right? There's always something deeper going on. And so I think that, you know, you asked who gets that there, that he's speaking Hebrew. The entire theater on the Upper West Side where I saw the first Borat movie, it was the first screening after Shabbat. So everybody who was there was a Hebrew speaker and everybody started laughing except for like, I don't know, like four people who were like, we don't see anything funny yet. And we just were like, you don't understand. It's the Hebrew was music to our ears because it was really there just for us. It was a coding, but it was also like a gift. And I think that Sacha Baron Cohen has been also so interesting in the way that he, especially these days, has come out as an activist against anti-Semitism and about, you know, misuse of Facebook and really speaking his activism into the world. You know, talking to, I think it was the ADL or something like that. He did a speech for them. And, you know, so in some ways you can say, well, he's engaging with stereotyping and, you know, he's maybe using Hebrew in a way that we don't think is Lashon HaKodesh, is not like the holy language of Hebrew. You know, it may be used in a very kind of like rough way, but he's still like identifying himself as Jewish. And especially when you're talking about like exposing Judaism, exposing anti-Semitism through one's own Jewish identity and hiding your Jewish identity, but also speaking Hebrew in a way that was like, it's really very layered. And it'll take a smarter person than me to unpack why, you know, how that all works together. But I'm not 1,000% comfortable with every stunt Sacha Baron Cohen pulls, but I am 1,000% appreciative of his use of Hebrew. And in fact, when I saw the new movie, I had the TV setting had gotten a little bit weird. And so it didn't show me, I don't know why, I was never able to duplicate this on purpose, but it didn't show me the English subtitle translations of what he was saying in Hebrew. So I only heard the Hebrew and I'm like, is he just going to speak only in Hebrew with no translation the entire rest of this movie? Because I thought it was like crazy how much Hebrew there was. And then I realized there was a setting I needed to, you know, flip on and off, and then the subtitles came back. But it was remarkable. And like, I think it's in some ways, you know, I mean, my dad, Al Kustanowitz, who's over there, could tell you more about your show of shows and like how there was a lot of Yiddish there masquerading as German gibberish. But I think that if it's a space of comfort for him to be playing in Hebrew, because it is not a gibberish language, it is a real language, and it's a real language that he knows, but not many other people know. So they may interpret it as gibberish, but he knows what he's saying and what he wants to say. And so it's comfortable for him to play in that language. So I think that's really unusual, but I'd love to see more of that.
Yeah. And it's Al will appreciate this, that in the class, we watched that German general sketch from your show of shows and sort of looked at what Sid Caesar is doing there with the double talk. And if people haven't seen it before, please Google or go onto YouTube and just look up your show of shows, German general. It's one of the most brilliant sketches, you know, I've seen. He's amazing. Yeah.
And there's also Mel Brooks, who does, you know, does Yiddish in some of his movies. My dad is like mouthing the words already. He knows exactly what I'm talking about. But you know, there's
we just did that last week. Lozengain,
right? Yeah. So like, you know, the idea that you can use a language that you know and that you love and that you have an affection for, but everybody else, it'll just read, except to your family. It's like Carol Burnett, you know, pulling on her ear. You know, like nobody. her grandmother, that was for her grandmother. She would just do that and it'd be like, I love you, grandma, right? So so it's just like an inside joke for my homies, as they like to say.
So let me ask you one last question just to wrap up. And I think it builds on that last point, which is, if we're seeing like more specific Jewish references on TV, right? Like more insider material, is this American Jews sort of translating what Jewishness means for a broader audience? Or do you think this is American Jews kind of sort of celebrating and finding more pride in their Jewishness and finding that as the basis of an identity, right? So you talk about like more secularized millennials, Gen Zs, who think of themselves culturally as Jewish, but not necessarily religiously as Jewish. Do you see this becoming sort of the basis of, you know, 21st century Jewish identity that it revolves around what's on TV and what's in the movies and what you eat? And it's not even necessarily being translated for a broader audience. It's just kind of speaking to a more insular Jewish audience.
Yeah, I mean, I think that there's a lot of value right now placed on like specific stories of people and where they come from. And whatever that means, it could mean where they come from religiously or, you know, geographically or culturally. And so I think that as we see, as Hollywood diversifies, you know, I think that we're seeing more of those, more permission to tell those stories, which celebrate difference, that ordinarily would have meant sharing that story of difference would have meant exclusion in the past. I think now it means inclusion, which is really, I think, remarkable. I've been on a couple of panels with a friend of mine who's a Muslim woman who basically talks about this kind of stuff, but for not about Jews, but about Muslims on TV. And she says that, you know, she wishes that the Muslim community or where the Jewish community was in terms of identifying our specific stories and being able to tell them on screen, because they haven't been given that permission yet. They're starting as more Muslim Americans are moving ahead in the industry. You know, it's becoming a more acceptable place to tell those stories. And Eitan writes out, Rami on Hulu is excellent. Yes, and there's a character on Legends of Tomorrow, which is a comic book related series on the CW, where there's a Muslim character there. And there are people who say randomly like Mazel Tov and L'chaim, but like they're not Jewish. But there is a identified Muslim character who is observant of Ramadan and doesn't eat bacon and like all of those things. And those things are kind of laying the groundwork for cultural literacy of what it means to be a Muslim American in a contemporary world. And I think that and even though Jews have been involved with the industry for such a long time, there was so much shame in being culturally specific to your Judaism that, you know, you had all the studio heads changing their names. You had the actors changing their names. Nobody wanted to go near any content that had to do with Judaism or the war unless it was extremely non-Jewish. So I think that, you know, the pride angle, and the identifying as something other than just American, I think we're kind of like edging more into the salad bowl instead of the melting pot of what it means to have an identity in America, that you can be American and Jewish, you can be American and Muslim, you can be American, Black and Jewish, or American, Black and Muslim. You know, you can be anything and anything, and they're both parts of you, and they're both things that you might want to celebrate and find places, spaces where you can celebrate that, both in your social communities and also in the content that you consume. So I think that's definitely a good thing. I think increasing people's cultural literacy about how people are different is not about othering them or fearing them, but about getting to know them. And I really appreciate that opportunity. And I'm glad that there are so many Jewish creators out there putting different kinds of Jews up on TV so that we can all see, oh, there are different kinds of Jews. Now, they're not all, you know, bums or criminals or, you know, restrictive Haredi people who want to oppress women. Like it's not, it's, Are those people out there? Sure, but they're also part of a larger whole. And I think the more stories, the better for everybody.
Esther, thank you. This has really been an amazing sort of program overview of all of this. It's really fascinating. So please join me, everyone, in thanking Esther for a wonderful presentation. I'll do this silent round of applause. There's lots of applause coming in for you. I've put it in gallery mode so we can see all the applause. So I want to thank you really for an excellent, excellent program. I want to thank everyone for joining us here this evening. And thank you to my students. We will discuss this tomorrow in class, and we'll look forward to seeing all of you again soon at upcoming programs. Thank you so much. Have a good night.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Bye, everybody.